King, before we talk about your group's efforts to keep the EDSA spirit alive, let's talk about what went wrong. In hindsight, what do you think actually contributed to the fizzling of the EDSA People Power fire? Why was the momentum of the EDSA People Power revolution not sustained over the years?
I think we took it for granted. We thought when we achieved that victory, that everything would just fall in place. It was not understanding that, in fact, time would move, new generations would come in. In a way, you can say the Filipino has not been good in recognizing its history. Filipinos have not been good in telling our story. From, you know, even World War II, what happened there. It's just like every time we go, when we have a crisis and we get over it, then it's the spirit is just to move on. But no, I think what the lesson is, no, we have to understand what we went through. We have to understand what we did to overcome it. We have to understand what needs to happen so that it doesn't happen again. And that's what we're I hope more and more. And I'm very happy that young people are coming on board, that even they're saying that even if we were not there, and they say that we can't remember, is that in fact we are going to be able to embed it in our national psyche, this recognition of our history, something that we will keep on telling the story, because it should become part of our DNA. That victory, that spirit of having fought, that spirit of having won, the joy of having won, the understanding that there's responsibility here that needs to be carried forward.
Ging, talk to us about the challenges of mounting campaigns to keep the EDSA spirit alive, considering that first, you have another Marcos in power, and second is that a chunk of the youth sector nowadays seems to lack the vigor in engaging with the movement.
Well, yes, we know that disinformation has in fact marked the last years. The use of social media to distort the story, to reverse the story. That is there. That people almost hardly pay attention anymore to asking the question, is that true? Is that fact? Or is that fiction? It's like they have already bought into a narrative, and even if you tell them, no, this is what happened, they just won't listen anymore. That is a big challenge, and I think it's a big challenge not just here, but in many parts of the world. And it is part of what we have to find out how to do, how to use social media, but also how to strengthen the personal bonds and get them people back again to understanding why it is important that we move on the basis of evidence, why we move on the basis of facts. Mm. On the matter of the youth, I think the reality is it is a very divided youth. Even as we say that so many of the young people have bought into the fake narrative, the reality is also that there are so many young people that have that are woke. That have risen up during the last elections, that continue. We are very pleased with the, but although there's still so much work to do, but that schools have come on board, that young people are volunteering. It is not going to be easy. No, it's not going to be easy. But we are heartened by the young people, the core of young people who are coming forward, claiming the narrative, claiming their part, because really, it's going to have to be them that will continue to shape this. But a big issue, and it is something that we keep on saying. Tama na sana yung paglalaro sa chacha, yung away-away sa politika, because we have such big problems. It's a problem in the education sector. When people become reliant on quick news, lack of attention span, just quickly jumping on because it's on TikTok, That's a problem. We have to, and we know that that is very much a part of the issues that confront the education sector. We need to get people back to understanding words, to understanding histories, to understanding, to be critical about their thinking, to be critical about what they see.
Mm-hmm. And Ging, to remedy the situation, I understand that your group will be mounting a series of events in the coming days. Tell us more about what will happen on February 23rd and February 25th. How many people or delegates are we expecting?
All right, yes, we are planned. In fact, it's month-long activities because in other parts of the Philippines and even here in Manila, activities are already going on. These are community-based. They're telling stories. They're cleaning up. They're doing palugaw. They're showing films. But on the 23rd, we have in this coming weekend four big events. On the on February 23rd, which is the first day, no? the call to come to EDSA happened on the evening of February 22. So the first day, February 23rd, we are having a mass at the EDSA Shrine and are calling for a National Day of Prayer and Action, a panalangin at pagkikilos, where we will, because our country has faced so many problems, and part of that is the non-recognition of our history, and that we will be launching also a prayer there that we hope people will take up and pray every day that we are brought back to the right path. On Sunday, there are three big events. February 25 at 7:30 in the morning, the Freedom Ride in Ayala Avenue. It is Snow Car Day. So we are inviting people to come to the monument of Ninoy Aquino, offer wreath, offer flowers, and enjoy the day. Please wear yellow. It will be a leisurely ride, but it will be part of our claiming the day of February 25 as an important day in our history. At 10 a.m. at Club Filipino, there will be there is the event we call the EDSA Story, claiming our victory, a nation's glory, which is going to be a commemoration of the oath-taking of President Cory Aquino at 10 a.m. It is going to tell the story of EDSA, from what we came from, the abuses of martial law, how we overcame it, and the EDSA moment itself, including the constitution that would be a major legacy of our EDSA experience, people power experience. It will be told in multimedia creative forms. It is part of trying to get our youth to understand that story. Mm-hmm. And then at in the evening, starting from about 2 p.m., there will be booths up at the White Plains Avenue right behind the People Power Monument. The booths will be there. All games, merchandise will be there. The start of coming together for a concert, a big concert with artists of different generations, again telling the story, reenacting some of the scenes. It will be a countdown from 7 p.m. to 9:05, which is the time, 9:05 p.m., which is the time the dictator was flown out of the country to Hawaii.
All right, Ging, I understand that I understand that several opposition figures will be participating in some of these events. But what do you actually say to observations that the opposition has been quite silent under the second Marcos administration?
It always takes some time. It always takes some time to get together. We needed, if what you would call the opposition, also needed to understand better what is the nature of this administration, because it's different. It's different from the one that went before. It's different in its history. It's different in its, and then trying to understand what are its intentions moving forward. We are the EDSA, the Buhayang EDSA campaign network is saying, whatever it is, the political opposition being in place or not, it is now time. It is now time for every Filipino to look, to decide how it is that they want the country to move forward. Do we want to continue with this playing with the politics and using it only for the service and the gratification of families and dynasties? Or do we at last want a long sustained effort to put our country forward, recognizing how difficult the past years have been, the period of division, of misogyny, of polarization, on top of that, the biggest crisis that the planet has faced with COVID, and the challenges of climate change. Whatever our politics, I think the call is really, let's take a look at the country and don't wait for someone else to take the leadership. There is always you, and you can always decide for yourself what to do. You can always get together with other people who think like you. And again, we will grow as we did during the martial law years, grow cell by cell, block by block, to come to that moment. Big challenge. We are sometimes feeling so disheartened that we seem to be in this cycle of boom and bust. We think we are going well, and then a repeat again of bad history. But that's how it is. We try to learn. We try to learn from each moment, and we try to learn that this time around, for the sake of our children and our children's children, let's think beyond ourselves.
All right.
And see what is it we really need to do for our country.
Okay, Ging, you mentioned that the opposition had to spend some time assessing what kind, the nature of this new administration, what its intentions are. But based on your assessment, how similar or how different is the Marcos Jr. administration from the rule of his father, former president and late dictator Ferdinand Marcos Sr.?
Well, we haven't seen the the use of military might or the threatening of people's movements, but until that history is recognized, then there is that problem, and that is, I think, what we are asking the president to recognize. The history, to recognize what happened under the rule of his father, and to we give him every chance, we give him every opportunity to distinguish himself from that history. But it cannot happen unless he recognizes, unless there is recognition and acknowledgement of what happened then, and what we lost, and what the people gained in this moment of EDSA, right, and how the real effort of unity that he talked about, that he ran on his campaign, must be real. It cannot be tactical. It cannot be a coming together because of self-serving interests. It cannot be a coming together only to vindicate a family name. It has to be a coming together that really looks at the nation.
All right. Speaking of the Marcos family name, you mentioned that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is not using military might. We also noticed that he is more open when it comes to criticism, as well as to journalists reporting about his administration. Do you think that the Marcos family is succeeding, or at least is on the right track to rehabilitating the Marcos family name?
That is why we need to. You know, it's always possible. They cannot rehabilitate that history. Can he make his own legacy? Oh yes. Can he determine that in full recognition of the damage that was done to the country by his father's rule, that he needs to take another track, really be with the people, not plunder, not just take it easy on the problems of the country, That is possible, and that continues to be our prayer. And that is why we continue to call on everyone. We need to rise. We need to say this is our history. We need to claim what we know happened, because it is important that this leadership knows that the country needs it, recognizes it, and we need for this. In a world that is quickly moving, in a world that is facing so many problems, in a world where our neighbors are advancing so much more quickly than us, it's time to really pay attention to that.
Mm-hmm. And Ging, finally, we are nearing the halfway mark of the Marcos Jr. administration. The filing of the certificates of candidacies for the 2025 midterm elections happening in a few months. What's in store for the opposition? What can we expect? Do we expect an opposition slate in the coming midterm polls?
What I understand is that the political leadership in the opposition are working on it. What I understand is that citizens are hoping it will have are hoping for that and are working on that. In fact, people have started working, beginning with the Sangguniang Kabataan elections and the barangay elections, to engage in that, and there have been some victories there. I think it's important to understand that there are going to be no shortcuts. I think maybe that was one mistake. When we thought that throwing out the dictator, it was just going to be a quick jump into something different. It's going to be small. It's going to have to be step by step. Every day we work on it. And so there is that. We know that people are working, but we need to work so much harder. And we continue to be hopeful. We continue to trust in the Filipino people, as in the past. Every time we push came to shove, we were there. We were ready. We are continuing to hope. We are continuing to trust that that is there, the love for the country, the trust in the people, the love of freedom continues to be inflamed in our hearts. And that, yes, slowly but surely, we are coming together. We are establishing a new path, and we are calling on our leadership. And we trust that more and more of them are listening and finally understanding that that is what leadership means.
And we will have to leave it at that for now. Thank you so much for making time for us this morning, former peace advisor and Buhayang EDSA Campaign Network co-convener, Ging Deles.
Maraming salamat po. Buhay ang EDSA.